one of the most interesting and eccentric composers of all time, and to this day has a cult-like following due to his music and philosophies that he held during his lifetime. Alexander Nikolaevich Scriabin. Like many other composers during the first two decades of the 20th century, Scriabin wanted to and was moving beyond common practice tonality. He stands out in history because he created his own unique post-tonal language, fully independent of Schoenberg, and coupled with his mystic philosophies, self-claim synesthesia, and messianic delusions, Alexander Scriabin would greatly intrigue Russia and the rest of the world. Alexander Scriabin was born on Christmas Day, according to the Julian calendar, into a military family of some nobility. His mother was a gifted pianist, but died when he was only one. Scriabin dreamed of a career in the military, and in 1882, at age 10, he joined the Moscow Cadet School. He was quite small and was often bullied, and even at a young age, he showed signs of neurosis and mental instability, and so was eventually dismissed, and his career as a soldier would never happen. His musical obsession had begun at a very young age. He started playing piano at age 4. By age 6, he could play almost anything he had heard performed once. In 1888, when he was 16, Scriabin entered the Moscow Conservatory. One of his friends and fellow students was Sergei Rachmaninoff. Scriabin graduated from the Moscow Conservatory in 1892. For the next few years following graduation, Scriabin mostly spent his time boozing it up and sleeping around. In his drunken states, he would often claim that he was greater than God. Thankfully, he would eventually overcome his alcohol addiction. In 1894, Scriabin gave his first concert in St. Petersburg. That same year, he began an international concert career, and he would visit Germany, France, Switzerland, and Italy, to name a few. In 1897, he married Vera Isakovich, who was herself an excellent pianist. The marriage wasn't without its faults. There's a lot of personality clashes and financial problems. To try to help, Scriabin, in 1898, got a job teaching piano at the Moscow Conservatory. This job only lasted till 1902. Scriabin wasn't the best teacher, and he was well known for making bad remarks and comments about Beethoven, Mendelssohn, and Brahms. Scriabin abandoned his wife and kids and embarked on a 6-year European journey with Tatiana Schlosser, a young admirer. It's during this time, when traveling abroad, that Scriabin begins to develop an original sound, experimenting with new harmonic structures and looking for new sonorities. One of his more famous works was composed during this time, and that is the Divine Poem, first published in 1904. Scriabin and Vera would eventually divorce in 1904. Oddly enough, though, Vera would continue playing her ex-husband's works until her death in 1920. 1905, Scriabin began living with Tatiana. He had known her since she was 15. They got married, had 2 girls, and a boy named Julian, who would compose 4 preludes himself. As I mentioned before, from about 1903 until 1908, Scriabin lived abroad. He lived in Paris, and he also lived in Belgium. It's during this time while living in Belgium that Scriabin begins to adopt new philosophies that will permeate his music and take over his life. In Belgium, he meets notorious theosophist Helena Blavatsky. Theosophy is somewhat of a cult of different philosophies that professes one can know God through spiritual ecstasy, direct instruction, or a special virtual relationship with Him. Scriabin embraced theosophy and would use it as a framework and foundation the rest of his life. Poem of Ecstasy, written in 1908, and Prometheus in 1910. Both of these symphonic works represent Scriabin's newfound philosophies, and that his music was a bridge for musical ecstasy. Helena Blavatsky claimed to have mind powers, and even though she was proven a fraud in 1914, Scriabin continued to believe in her. During his final years, his mental instability increased. He would say that he was greater than Jesus Christ, tried to walk on water even, preached to fishermen on a boat. He also was convinced that Jesus was a communist. While in London, Scriabin became ill due to a pimple on his upper lip underneath that glorious mustache of his. This was most likely caused from nicking himself while shaving. The pimple became infected and he contracted blood poisoning or sepsis and died on Easter, April 14th, 1915. His birth date and death date being Christmas and Easter also helped to contribute to this view that Scriabin was this sort of messiah. After his death, some came to aid his family, and Rachmaninoff was one of them. Julian Scriabin, who was Scriabin's son, showed signs of following his father's musical footsteps. However, tragically, Julian drowned in the Dnieper River 4 years after his father's death. He was only 11. Scriabin passed away during the First World War, which he believed would cleanse mankind and usher in a glorious new era of mystical wonder. Scriabin was inspired by Wagner's Gesamtkunstwerk, or total synthesis of all the arts. And from this, Scriabin planned on composing a gigantic, epic piece, The Mysterium. Just to show how dedicated Scriabin was to theosophy and his views, he went so far as to buy land in India, a small piece of land. And the performance of Mysterium was to take place in a half temple to be built in India, where he bought the land. The Himalayas would be the backdrop. Bells suspended from clouds would summon the spectators from all over the world. A reflecting pool of water would complete the divinity of the half-circle stage. Spectators would sit in tiers across the water. Scriabin would be seated at the piano, surrounded by hosts of instrumentalists, singers, and dancers. Costumed speakers reciting text in processions and parades would form part of the action along with the dancers, whose choreography would include eye motions and touches of the hands in conjunction with odors of both pleasant perfume and acrid smoke. Pillars of incense would form part of the scenery. A light show, bathing the cast and audience in changing effects, would also be included. This is the piece that would commence the end of the world.